Hi everyone, Dr. Jemison here again, and we're going to do a video lecture today covering chapter 29 of our book, and that is going to be normal structure and function physiology of the urinary system. So let's transition into the PowerPoint here, and let me set up my pointer here. There we go, laser pointer. All right, I think we're ready to go. Okay, so for as far as the urinary system goes, hopefully a lot of this will be review, and you can remember most of what you learned in anatomy and physiology whenever you took it. But when we're looking at the urinary system, we're looking at the kidneys, the ureters, the urinary bladder, the urethra. That is the direction of flow that we're going to be following. And then at the second half of this lecture, we're going to look in detail about the physiology of the urinary system, mostly looking at what's going on in the kidneys, and specifically filtration, reabsorption, and secretion, and then how the body regulates urine volume. So just as a quick refresher, we've got two kidneys, a right and a left kidney, and the tubes that are draining urine filtrate from the kidneys, those are the ureters. We have two of them, and ureters will empty that urine into the urinary bladder, which is a holding station, basically a holding bladder for urine. And we've got a couple sphincter muscles down here that keep the bladder closed, and we can control one of those sphincters actually with our conscious minds and allow ourselves to empty the bladder. And when that occurs, urine will flow out through the urethra and then outside of the body. So there's only one urethra, we've got two ureters here, and a urinary bladder. Looking at a little bit more detailed picture of the urinary tract, we've got our two kidneys right here, and actually the right kidney and the left kidney do not sit at the same level in the body. One of them is lower than the other. Can you think about which one might be sitting lower? If you're thinking that it's the right kidney, you're correct, because we've got the big portion of the liver sitting right above where the kidney is, and that takes up space. And so the right kidney actually sits a little bit lower in the body than the left kidney. And so the right ureter is a little bit shorter than the left ureter. So just some anatomical landmarks there to remember. Kidneys get a lot of blood supply because kidneys' main job is to filter out fluids and metabolites and toxins out of the blood and filter it out, creating urine, and then we get rid of that urine out the urethra. So let's look at the bladder in just a little bit more detail, close up. If we were to open up or cut away the front of the bladder, this is what we would see inside. We would notice that the ureters actually empty into the bladder at the posterior part of the bladder, down towards the base of the bladder. So we've got the two ureteral meatuses, or openings of the ureters, that's emptying into the bladder. And this triangular area here that I'm outlining with the laser pointer, that's known as the trigon. And the trigon has a unique mucosa to it that's different than the rest of the urinary bladder, in that it's not very expandable and it's a smoother urinary mucosa. All of this other bladder lining and bladder tissue, the bladder mucosa, is comprised of this transitional epithelium. And it's transitional meaning that it's actually a single layer epithelium, but when the bladder is empty, it folds up on itself. And then as the bladder fills and increases in volume, that transitional epithelium expands as well. And it just helps make that mucosa more dynamic and more accommodating for the repetitive dilation and emptying of the bladder. So notice also that we have a smooth muscle layer here of the bladder, and it's comprised of, like I said, smooth muscle, so it's under autonomic nervous system control, and it has a special name. We call this the detrusor muscle, and the detrusor muscle is that main muscular layer around the urinary bladder. And we've got an internal urinary sphincter here, and then an external urinary sphincter a little bit further away from the urinary bladder. External urinary sphincter, that is comprised of skeletal muscles. So this is the sphincter that we do have conscious control over, and as humans are being potty trained, learning to be continent, we're learning how to control this external urinary sphincter. Internal urinary sphincter, autonomic nervous system control. So we don't really have a whole lot of say into when that sphincter relaxes or contracts. Also, notice in this example here, we've got a prostate gland that's surrounding the urethra, just the proximal urethra. And so we're looking at a male urinary tract here. So the females would not have this prostate gland surrounding the urethra. And in this image, portions of the prostate have been cut away. So the prostatic urethra actually goes straight through the prostate. Yeah, I think that's about it that I wanted to say there. Trivia time. What's the medical term for where the kidneys are located in the body? Notice here, right kidney, they've got it right here. Or I'm sorry, they've got it correct here where it's sitting lower than the left kidney, and that's because the liver is taking up so much space on the right-hand side. But what is that term that we use to describe where the kidneys are situated in the body? Well, it's retroperitoneal, meaning that the kidneys are sitting behind the peritoneal cavity. So here's a cross-section look at somebody's abdomen, as if we were looking at it with from a CT scan or even an MRI scan, where we're looking from the bottom up. So their head would be away from us, and their feet would be behind us, really, is what's going on here. And so we've got the two kidneys here, right kidney, left kidney, and then they have on this picture outlined in blue the peritoneal cavity. And notice that the kidneys are sitting behind the peritoneal cavity. And that is to our advantage, really. It not only helps to protect the kidneys, but it helps keep the kidneys situated in place. So the kidneys are surrounded by normal renal fat that offers some protection as well, but they're tightly packed away back there in the retroperitoneal cavity. So the kidneys don't move around at all, not like the intestines would or some of the other intra-abdominal organs and structures. So let's look at the kidney itself in a little bit more detail. Notice with this kidney's cut away, we can see a difference in the characteristics of the tissue that makes up the kidney. We've got the outer layer, the renal cortex, which is made up of this lighter tissue, and then these triangular shapes that are found in the renal medulla. And these are the renal pyramids, these triangular darker red shapes. And then in between each renal pyramid, we find what we label as renal columns. So as far as what tissue types or what kind of tissue is in the renal medulla, we've got the renal columns and then the renal pyramids. And then the renal cortex is the outermost layer. Also, deeper to the renal pyramids, we've got these renal papillae. And this is where urine is actually emptying from the pyramids into the renal pelvis. So these small areas right here, these are the renal papillae. And then we've got the minor calyxes, major calyxes, and then finally the renal pelvis right here. All of that urine that's being drained out of the renal pyramids is collected through the minor and major calyxes and into the renal pelvis, and then that's sent on down the ureter in order to be stored in the urinary bladder. So what's going on in the renal cortex? That's basically filtration, and we'll talk about that coming up in renal physiology, but that's where the blood is being filtered. Water, electrolytes, toxic metabolites, those types of things are being filtered out of the blood in the renal cortex, and then in the renal medulla, that's where the urine is being concentrated. So we're taking back a large amount of that water that gets filtered out. Here's another up-close view. We've got the renal pyramids here and the renal columns that makes up the renal medulla. The renal cortex is this outermost layer. And if we were to look at a close-up view at this area right here where the cortex and the medulla interact, then what this image is showing us is that we've got two different types of filtering structures that we call nephrons, and we've got some that are more in the cortex and we call those cortical nephrons, and then other nephrons that are in charge of filtration and urine concentration that are found situated close to the medulla, and so we call that juxtamedullary nephrons. All of these vascular branches, I'm not going to ask you guys specific names about the vascular branches, but what I want you to realize here is that the renal artery is carrying a large volume of blood, and once that renal artery enters the kidney, it branches off really, really fast into smaller and smaller branches, and then finally we've got arterioles and capillaries, and so the kidneys are highly vascularized, and which is good because that's where we're filtering toxic things out of our blood through the kidneys. Oh, here we are. So the renal arteries receive about 25% of cardiac output. So that is a large volume of blood that's going directly to the kidneys for filtration and volume regulation. So here's another diagram showing all of the vasculature that's associated with kidney function. So we've got all of these blood vessels here that are wrapped around the proximal and distal convoluted tubules of the nephron, and then this network of capillaries that are crisscrossing the loop of Henle here, and this network of capillaries is called the vasa recta, and it's the vasa recta that is primarily going to be in charge of concentrating the urine and the exchange of electrolytes and other nutrients into and out of the bloodstream across the loop of Henle there. Here's another image illustrating all of the capillaries and the vasa recta that's associated with the renal pyramids. This is figure 29.5, just so that you can see another image of it. Something that's interesting, though, is with cortical nephrons, you can see that it has a really short loop of Henle. With juxtamedullary nephrons over here, really long loop of Henle. It dips way down into the renal pyramid. And with the juxtamedullary nephrons, this is where we have a lot of urine concentration going on. And with cortical nephrons, we don't have a very long loop of Henle, so the urine doesn't really get concentrated when it's going through these cortical nephrons. So let's talk about these nephrons. The nephrons are basically the functional unit of the kidney, and each kidney has over a million nephrons. And like I said in the previous slide, cortical nephrons have short loop of Henle, juxtamedullary nephrons have a long loop of Henle. And so we have more urine concentration happening in the urine filtrate that's filtered through juxtamedullary nephrons. So here we are again. Here's a cortical nephron. A nephron is comprised, well, I don't want to go into the parts just yet, but this whole structure right here would be considered a nephron. And then this whole structure right here would be considered a nephron also. So here we've got a cortical nephron and a very short loop of Henle, so not a whole lot of urine concentration is going on here. And then we have this juxtamedullary nephron that's close to the cortex medulla border. That's why it's called juxtamedullary. And it has its long loop of Henle that dips way down into the renal pyramid. And this is where we have a lot of urine concentration going on. So let's look at the nephron in its different parts, its components. And the first part that I want to look at is a structure called the renal corpuscle. The renal corpuscle is this whole structure right here that I have pictured in the slide. It's made up of the glomerulus and Bowman's capsule. And I want to make something clear here that the glomerulus is only, the word itself is only referring to this capillary structure right here, where we have this what looks like a tangled up ball of capillary. That is the glomerulus. So sometimes you'll see it labeled as glomerular capillaries, but then the whole structure of the capillaries is called the glomerulus. So the glomerulus is not the renal corpuscle, but the glomerulus is part of the renal corpuscle, which is this entire thing. Bowman's capsule is what the glomerulus sits inside of. And there's a space between the glomerular capillaries and the epithelium of Bowman's capsule, and we call that the capsular space. So when water and other elements are filtered out of the glomerular capillaries, it's collected in this space, into Bowman's space or capsular space. All of this is the renal corpuscle. And if we look here, we've got an afferent arteriole and an efferent arteriole. So the afferent arteriole is actually carrying blood that's going into the glomerular capillaries, and then the efferent arteriole is carrying blood away from the glomerular capillaries. So filtered blood is going through the efferent arteriole, and pre-filtered blood, if you will, is being carried and delivered into the glomerular capillaries by way of the afferent arteriole. So here's our glomerulus, or I'm sorry, here's our renal corpuscle with the glomerulus inside of it. So we've got this cutaway view of the glomerular capillaries. And in this picture, we have the afferent arteriole on top, bringing blood into the glomerular capillary structure, and then the efferent arteriole taking blood out of the glomerular capillaries. And we've got the capsular space here, colored in blue, and Bowman's capsule that's surrounding this ball of capillaries that we call the glomerulus. There's a couple other structures here that I want to point out. So when the afferent arteriole is delivering blood into the glomerular capillaries, that's where water, electrolytes, and other elements are being filtered out of the blood and collected into Bowman's space. And then that filtrate, that fluid that just got filtered, then moves through the proximal convoluted tubule, which is right here. They've got it labeled as the proximal tubule. And then that filtrate goes on down the loop of Henle and then through these other tubes that we'll talk about in a second. A couple other things that I wanted to highlight on this picture as well is a mislabeling. So this picture's from your book, and there's a mislabeled structure here. So here's the afferent arteriole, and they're highlighting the juxtaglomerular apparatus. And then they also have afferent arteriole for this structure here, but that's not right. This structure is the distal convoluted tubule, or this tube you're right here. Sometimes we call that the DCT. So I wanted to correct that mislabeling. Here's a pretty good image of what the renal corpuscle would look like. We've got the afferent arteriole bringing blood in, glomerular capillaries is where filtration is happening, and then the efferent arteriole taking blood away from the renal corpuscle. So let's look at some other parts of the nephron. Talked about the glomerulus and the glomerular capillaries, those small capillaries that are in that tangled up ball. That's where filtration is happening. So we have a filtration membrane that fluids and elements are crossing in order to get into the capsular space or Bowman's space. So the glomerular filtration membrane is made up of three structures. First structure that water will pass through is the capillary endothelium, and that's the glomerular capillary endothelium. And then it will pass through a shared basement membrane between the glomerular capillary endothelial cells and the capsular epithelial cells. And these have a special name because they're specialized epithelial cells. Those are the podocytes. So water or elements are going to filter past the capillary endothelium, past the shared basement membrane, and then through the capsular epithelial podocyte cells. And there's also filtration slits that will allow for certain elements to pass through as filtration is happening. So filtration occurs across these three layers, and that forms the primary filtrate, or that primary urine filtrate that's being collected in Bowman's space. So there's a couple characteristics about the glomerular filtration membrane that you need to keep in mind. Number one, you need to remember the three structures that water and elements will filter through or pass through. So in this cutaway view of glomerular capillaries, we see this yellow cell as the glomerular capillary endothelial cell, and showing us a couple of them here. This lighter blue membrane is the shared basement membrane between the glomerular endothelial cell and these capsular epithelial cells, or the podocytes, and those three structures make up the glomerular filtration membrane. So notice, if we take a even closer look, we have these filtration slits, and these slits are very, very small, and that's one of the things that prevent larger proteins and macromolecules from filtering out of the blood into the capsule space. The other important characteristic of the filtration membrane is that it holds a net negative charge. So there's a negative charge really on these endothelial cells in this filtration membrane, and that repels a lot of the larger proteins in the blood. So we've got these small filtration slits that's preventing large proteins from filtering out of the blood into capsule space, and also the negative charge that these endothelial cells have, or the filtration membrane has, and that repels proteins away from the filtration membrane. So those proteins like albumin and so on will stay inside the blood, inside this capillary, remaining in the blood. All right, so let's look at other specific parts of the nephron. And we have to mention the juxtaglomerular apparatus. You might remember this from anatomy and physiology, but let's review it. It's also can be abbreviated. You can call it the JG apparatus, juxtaglomerular apparatus. Juxta means next to. So this is an area next to the glomerulus that has specialized cells with specialized functions. And again, here's our view of the JG apparatus. We've got juxtaglomerular cells that are associated with the afferent arteriole. And then we've got the macula densa cells that are actually associated with the distal convoluted tubule. And these specialized cells, macula densa, juxtaglomerular cells, afferent arteriole in this area, and the DCT in this area, that all makes up the juxtaglomerular apparatus. So here's another view of it. This one's labeled correctly. We've got our afferent arteriole bringing blood into the glomerulus, and our juxtaglomerular cells that are right around, surrounding the afferent arteriole, right before it goes into the renal corpuscle. And then also, distal convoluted tubule has a section that courses right next to this afferent arteriole, and that's where we find these specialized epithelial cells of the DCT called the macula densa cells. So what do these cells do? Here's what I want you to know. Macula densa is mostly detecting. So it's measuring pressure and concentration of the urine filtrate that's traveling through the distal convoluted tubule. And based on the measurements that it's reading, it can communicate that to juxtaglomerular cells. And these juxtaglomerular cells, their main job is to secrete or release products. And one of those secretions is the hormone renin, and also one that we know already, erythropoietin or EPO. So in the case of low blood flow or low blood pressure going through the afferent arteriole, that's going to affect what the macula densa cells are measuring, and that will stimulate the JG cells, juxtaglomerular cells, to secrete erythropoietin. And then, as we know, EPO, its target tissue is the bone marrow, to produce, or stimulating the bone marrow to produce more red blood cells so that we can get more oxygen and more blood flow coming through the afferent arteriole. And we'll talk about what renin does in just a few more minutes. Here's another way to look at it. Here's a cross-section of the distal convoluted tubule, and these larger columnar-looking cells, those are the macula densa cells. And afferent arteriole right here, juxtaglomerular cells surrounding the afferent arteriole right before it goes into the renal corpuscle, and that makes up the JG, or the juxtaglomerular apparatus. So they also have labeled on this picture the direction of blood flow. So blood flow is coming into the glomerular capillaries by way of the afferent arteriole. Filtration occurs across the glomerular filtration membrane right here. And so that filtrate collects in Bowman's space, or the capsular space, and then that fluid is moved on through the proximal convoluted tubule. And then the blood is basically drained by the efferent arteriole. So look at how they've drawn it here, and this is actually really correct. The afferent arteriole has a larger diameter than the efferent arteriole. And that's true because we have a higher volume of blood coming in through the afferent arteriole than we do coming through the efferent arteriole, because that blood has lost a lot of water volume by way of filtration here inside Bowman's space. And so we don't need a larger blood vessel here. It's actually smaller because there's less volume to the blood that's being carried through the efferent arteriole. So here's a histological slide of a renal corpuscle. We've got glomerular epithelial cells in here. This space, this white space here, that's Bowman's space, or the capsular space. And then these large cells here are the macula densa cells, part of the distal convoluted tubule. All right, well, let's talk about where the urine filtrate goes after it's been filtered through the glomerular filtration membrane. It gets collected in Bowman's space, and then that fluid moves from Bowman's space through the proximal convoluted tubule, or the proximal tubule. I like to abbreviate it the PCT, proximal convoluted tubule. And then that fluid will travel through the loop of Henle, where we have a lot of the concentration going on of the urine. And then after it goes through the loop of Henle, it's collected by the distal convoluted tubule. And remember, there's a portion of the DCT, the distal convoluted tubule, that travels right by the afferent arteriole, and that's where the macula densa cells are found. And then all of that fluid is collected into larger and larger collecting ducts, and then ultimately will be drained from the renal pyramid into the renal papillae, the minor calyxes, the major calyxes, and then the renal pelvis, and then on down the ureter. So basically what's happening with the renal tubules, here are the tubules themselves, and here's the function that happens. The structures are up here, these top four structures, and then the functions are these bottom two. So water regulation, extracellular fluid or extracellular volume regulation, that's all managed by renal tubules. Reabsorbing sodium or not reabsorbing sodium. Remember, sodium has a best friend, and that friend is water. And wherever sodium goes, water is going to follow. So these are the main structures of the nephron that help to regulate volume of blood and extracellular fluid. Also, let's not forget that the kidneys play a major role in pH regulation by reabsorbing or excreting bicarb or even hydrogen ions, and then potassium is also a part of that as well. So here we are again, just an overall view of the nephron. So the nephron, functional unit of the kidney, it's comprised of the renal corpuscle, which has the glomerular capillaries in it, and the capsular space, and then the renal capsule or Bowman's capsule, that's the renal corpuscle. So afferent arterioles bringing blood into the renal corpuscle. We have filtration occurring across the glomerular filtration membrane, across those three structures that I highlighted earlier. So water and other elements are filtered out of the blood and collected into Bowman's space, and then moved through the proximal convoluted tubule all the way through here, down the loop of Henle, gets concentrated up the loop of Henle. That urine then passes by the macula densa. Macula densa is monitoring the concentration of that urine and the pressure inside the macula densa. And then that urine is collected into larger and larger collecting ducts. And then finally flows out of the renal pyramid and then eventually is gathered into the urinary bladder. All right, well, let's talk more physiology of the kidneys. And this is really the area that trips a lot of students up. It's the terminology that I've determined is what trips people up most of the time. So let's review filtration. Filtration here in the kidneys means the same thing as it does when we were talking about fluid balance in the capillaries. So filtration means water and other elements are being forced out of the capillary and into, in this case, Bowman's space. So that is filtration. Now we have reabsorption, which is has a similar definition that it did when we were talking about fluid balance. So reabsorption is the movement of water or other elements from the urinary or from the urine filtrate back into the blood supply. And that's happening all throughout the renal tubules, and it's going into the vasa recta and some of those capillaries that are crisscrossing around the renal tubules. And then we've got a new term here, secretion. Secretion in the kidneys, so renal secretion. And we'll look at the definition of that coming up in just a minute. Also, I wanted to highlight the hormones that are involved in the regulation of urine volume. So we have a lot of mechanisms in place that determine how much fluid or how much volume the urine comprises. So we've got the renin, aldosterone, angiotensin system or the RAS system, ADH, antidiuretic hormone, and then we've got a class of hormones called natriuretic peptides. We're going to look at those too. So let's look at filtration one more time in detail. So filtration, the definition's just right here. We're talking about renal filtration. It's the movement of water and non-protein solutes. That's an important point because remember, the filtration membrane has a negative charge and those very small filtration slits, and that keeps proteins from being filtered out. So we have proteins that are staying in the bloodstream in the glomerular capillaries. So when we're talking about renal filtration, we're talking about water and non-protein solutes. And that happens across the glomerular filtration membrane. And that filtrate is collected into Bowman's space or the capsular space. Couldn't be that easy. There's always more complicated things that we can throw at you for this. So let's complicate things a little bit. Actually, I'm not trying to complicate things. So let's decipher what's going on here. This image is describing net filtration pressure. So we've got the afferent arteriole bringing blood into the glomerulus, and then we have fluid balance, pressure, and forces that are at play here. And let's look at these. So this top arrow, this is the larger arrow, and we've got the hydrostatic pressure of glomerular capillaries. And they have it labeled as 55 millimeters of mercury. So anyway, that's the blood pressure of the glomerular capillaries. So that's exerting a pressure of 55. But that's not the only pressure that's at play here. We also have the oncotic and osmotic pressure of the glomerular capillaries. So how many solutes and proteins are inside the blood within the glomerular capillaries? So that's going to exert a water pulling effect, or a water pulling force, and that is a force of 30 millimeters of mercury. And then we also have the hydrostatic pressure of the capsular space, and that's how much fluid, how much pressure the fluid is exerting inside the capsular space. So that pressure exerted to the outside of the glomerulus, and that is measured here at 15. So to get net filtration, in order to have filtration occur, we need to have a positive number from this calculation. So here's the calculation here. It's basically the outward pressure, or the fluid filtration pressure, needs to be greater than the inward pressures. So outward pressure here in the top arrow, the hydrostatic pressure of the glomerular capillaries, minus the sum of the water pulling pressure, the reabsorption pressures here. So the oncotic osmotic pressure within the glomerular capillaries, and then the hydrostatic pressure of the fluid that's inside the capsular space. So as long as that's a positive number, like they have here is 10, we're going to have net filtration. So fluid, water, is going to move from the glomerular capillaries into Bowman's space. So then we have filtration happening. When we talk about pathologies affecting renal function, some of the pathologies that I'm going to mention have to do with a disruption in the filtration pressure here. So if the hydrostatic pressure of the glomerular capillaries is actually less than these other two pressures, then we will not have filtration happening. So then there will be no water moving or filtering from the glomerular capillaries into Bowman's space. So that would mean that toxic metabolites, things that the kidneys are normally filtering out, will not get filtered out in that case. And so they remain in the blood, and that can cause a lot of problems. But this example right here, this is showing normal filtration pressures, and it's a positive number. So we have positive filtration happening. Another way to describe that is the EFP, or effective filtration pressure. And the effective filtration pressure is basically determined, we've got it by four different concentration gradients or pressures, but really it's these first three. So one, two, three here. So remember the glomerular hydrostatic pressure, that's directly related to systemic blood pressure and also the resistance in the glomerular capillaries. And also glomerular osmotic and oncotic pressure, and then the capsular hydrostatic pressure. Capsular osmotic pressure, really negligible amount. So that's why I'm saying these top three, these are the main forces at play that will give us the net filtration pressure. You may have also heard of GFR, or glomerular filtration rate. And this is basically a calculation of how much volume of fluid is being filtered out of the glomerulus into the capsular space for a given period of time. And so that calculation is known as glomerular filtration rate, or GFR. It gives us a clinical idea as to how well the kidneys are working, how well filtration is happening in the kidneys. So we want a good GFR calculation, or a good GFR number, because that's telling us that there's effective filtration happening and the kidneys are doing their jobs. So GFR is directly proportional to the effective filtration pressure, but it can also be changed and modified by a couple different scenarios. So vasodilation or vasoconstriction of the afferent and efferent arterioles, that can affect how much blood flow is going into the glomerular capillaries and how much blood pressure is inside the glomerular capillaries. And then also changes in systemic blood pressure can have an effect on glomerular hydrostatic pressure as well. So there's various areas here that can change GFR depending on the physiologic needs of the body, or perhaps trying to compensate for some other pathology that's going on with the kidneys. Look at this. Filtration of approximately 180 liters of fluid per day. What do you guys think about that? I wish I could read your thoughts right now. Is anybody peeing out 180 liters of fluid in a day? Well, if they are, they're not going to live very long because they're getting rid of all of their fluid. So this is just to illustrate a point that through the glomerular filtration membrane and through the glomerulus, we have a lot of fluid that's going from our blood supply, from the blood solution into Bowman's space and then through the proximal convoluted tubule. That's a lot of fluid, 180 liters per day. But the good thing is that if the kidneys are working properly, we are not going to pee out 180 liters per day. So before I talk about how that happens or how that's prevented, let's look at GFR one more time and the forces involved with that. So we've got the hydrostatic pressure of the blood exerting a filtration pressure or a filtration force. And then we also have the glomerular hydrostatic pressure of the, well, it's basically the blood pressure of the glomerular capillaries. So these two pressures on the left, excuse me, will increase filtration if these pressures increase, and vice versa. Oh, I need to fix that. I misspelled that a long time ago. Anyway, if the hydrostatic pressure is high in the glomerular or in the glomerular capillaries, that's going to increase filtration. Or if the hydrostatic pressure dips too low, then that's going to decrease filtration. So let's look here on the right-hand side. We've got plasma osmotic, and I would include oncotic pressure within the glomerular capillaries, and then also the capsular hydrostatic pressure. So these two forces are opposing filtration, and they will actually cause a decrease in filtration if these forces increase. So if there's a high plasma osmotic and oncotic pressure and or a high capsular hydrostatic pressure, that can limit filtration or even stop filtration. And it all goes back to a slide a couple times ago. Let me go back to this slide and how these pressures sum out of the calculation. So how these all measure out. All right, moving forward. Let's talk reabsorption now. This is the process that prevents us from peeing out 180 liters of fluid every day. So as the filtrate moves through the renal tubules, it's exposed to a lot of different changes in renal tissue osmolarity, and that is what will cause fluid and other electrolytes and other elements in the filtrate to be reabsorbed back into the capillaries that are surrounding the renal tubules. So then I've got this question here: why does the kidney have this roller coaster of osmolarity, basically meaning why do we have these ups and downs of increasing and decreasing osmolarity as that filtrate travels through the renal tubules? Hold on to that thought. We'll discover that in just a few moments. So here's the definition of reabsorption. The movement of filtrate and substances that are in the filtrate out of the renal tubules and back into the bloodstream. So things like water, that's a good thing. Electrolytes, we want to hang on to a lot of those. Glucose, we spent all this time eating and digesting and absorbing our food to get glucose and other nutrients. We don't want to waste energy by filtering it out. So we reabsorb any glucose that happens to be filtered across the glomerular filtration membrane. Amino acids, again, we don't want to lose that stuff. We need to build proteins with amino acids. And so we reabsorb all of these elements out of the urine filtrate and back into the peritubular blood vessels. Here's an illustration of how this occurs. So we've got filtration occurring across the glomerular filtration membrane, water, electrolytes, glucose to a certain extent, amino acids get filtered out, but we want those things. The body needs those things back. We spend a lot of energy obtaining them, and so we want to hang on to them. And so reabsorption occurs across the renal tubules back into the peritubular capillaries. And then there's only one area where this occurs by way of active transport, meaning that it takes ATP to move these substances. So, and that's at step one, right in the proximal convoluted tubule, we've got sodium and potassium reabsorbed by way of active transport. And if you want to think of something that you might, as an example, that takes energy to get the whole system going, this is where the roller coaster analogy comes into place. So this step right here, early on in the proximal convoluted tubule, it takes the use of ATP to get sodium and potassium back into the bloodstream, and that's the active transport. That's like the roller coaster going up that first hill. It takes energy to deliver everybody in their coaster cars up to the top of the first hill. And then once they go down that first hill, it's all kinetic energy after that. So this is the only place where active transport is needed. All throughout the renal tubules, the movement of ions and water, that's all being managed by changes in osmolarity. So it doesn't take any more ATP to reabsorb those elements. So that's why the filtrate goes through this roller coaster of changes in concentration of osmolarity. So here we've got proximal convoluted tubule. The osmolarity is at 300, and it will start changing its concentration by way of active transport and becoming more and more concentrated. And then as that filtrate goes down the loop of Henle, it becomes more and more concentrated because water is being pulled out of the filtrate into the peritubular capillaries. And so that is why in the beginning of this lecture I was saying that the loop of Henle is where the concentration of urine is happening. Concentration meaning we're taking water out of the urine filtrate because we need that water. We want it back. And so as that filtrate goes up the loop of Henle, we've got the movement of other ions like sodium and chloride, and that changes the osmolarity of the urine, and then more water can be reabsorbed by way of the collecting ducts and distal convoluted tubules. So you might have nightmares of physiology when you see the words countercurrent exchange. I'm not going to go into the details of countercurrent exchange, but basically what I want you to know about countercurrent exchange is this is the mechanism that pulls water out of the filtrate, allowing for reabsorption, and it's that filter or the traveling of the filtrate through various concentrations within the renal medulla or the renal pyramid that allows for the exchange of ions and water until finally we get the finished product of urine, concentrated or otherwise. And that whole process is known as countercurrent exchange. I'm not really concerned that you know the nitty-gritty details of this. All right, so we did filtration, we did reabsorption. Now let's introduce and talk about secretion. Secretion is not filtration. What secretion is the movement of substances from the peritubular blood vessels and the renal tissue itself into the renal tubules. And this is how the body gets rid of more metabolites, how it regulates pH by secreting hydrogen ions into the urine filtrate, or secreting urea or ammonia, potassium for to a certain extent. And this is mostly occurring at the distal convoluted tubule. So secretion is the movement of substances from the peritubular blood vessels or the renal tissue directly into the distal convoluted tubule for the most part. So it's not filtration, but it's similar. Oh gosh, this picture is so blurry. Let me help you understand what's going on here. So we've got our renal corpuscle here where filtration is happening. Proximal tubule, loop of Henle, distal tubule collecting duct. So we're following the urine filtrate as it's traveling through these tubes, and the blue boxes are showing items that are reabsorbed. So in the proximal convoluted tubule, we have reabsorption of most of our essential elements that probably got filtered out across the glomerular filtration membrane. So glucose, yeah, we want to hang on to that for sure. Amino acids, protein to a certain extent, vitamins, and so on. So all of these electrolytes as well. So the blue boxes are showing substances that are reabsorbed. The red boxes are labeling substances that are secreted. So moving from the peritubular capillaries or just the renal tissue itself, pushing these elements into the renal tubules, and things like urea, uric acid, hydrogen ions, and so on. So some mechanisms and players that are involved in the concentration and dilution of urine are listed right here. So urea plays a role in that to a certain degree. I want to focus on aldosterone, antidiuretic hormone, and atrial natriuretic peptide. So as we'll see when we do the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, what aldosterone does to the nephrons or to the renal tubules is it will stimulate sodium reabsorption. And wherever sodium goes, water is going to follow. So remember, reabsorption, aldosterone is going to stimulate the movement of sodium and water from the urine filtrate back into the blood supply by way of the peritubular capillaries. That's what aldosterone is doing. Antidiuretic hormone, think about what the name is telling us, antidiuretic or antidiuresis. So ADH is going to stimulate water reabsorption, and it's not manipulating water by moving sodium. This is just straight up water reabsorption. Atrial natriuretic peptide, or sometimes we've seen it in class as atrial natriuretic hormone, same thing. These are a group of peptide hormones that have a natriuretic property to them. So ANP, or atrial natriuretic peptide, is produced by special cells within the atria of the heart that when the heart chamber or when the atriums get stretched too far because blood volume is too high, those specialized cells will then release ANP into the bloodstream, and they will stimulate the kidneys to secrete sodium and therefore water. So this will have an effect of decreasing blood volume by increasing urine volume. So that's what ANP is doing. And then diuretics, we have this class of drugs that manipulate sodium and potassium and water secretion and filtration in the kidneys as well. So it's not pharmacology class, but I just want you guys to realize that that's where that class of drugs is having its effect, is on the kidneys, to get rid of more water from the blood supply, and that will help bring blood pressure down. Okay, this is figure 2910 from the chapter, and I like it because it has our nephron stretched out in a straight line, so it's not all tangled up. It's giving us the structure. So we've got the glomerulus within Bowman's capsule here. So this is the renal corpuscle, proximal tubule, loop of Henle, distal tubule, collecting duct. And then it's telling us the specialized function of each of these structures. So the main function of the glomerulus or the renal corpuscle is for filtration. That's it. Proximal convoluted tubule, reabsorption, and then some secretion, loop of Henle, concentration of urine. That's its main function here of the renal tubule, the loop of Henle, is to concentrate urine, meaning that we're pulling water out of the urine filtrate. And then the distal tubule is where we have reabsorption of some elements, but also secretion of a lot of other things that we want to get rid of. So secretion meaning taking urea, for instance, from the kidney tissue and putting it right in to the distal convoluted tubule for excretion so that we can get rid of it. And then the collecting ducts, we've got some reabsorption and secretion happening here. I don't want you to memorize every single thing on this picture. I do want you to know, however, that, well, as you're studying this, that the reabsorption that's occurring in the proximal convoluted tubule does not require ADH. So the reabsorption of water, sorry, I should clarify, the reabsorption of water doesn't require ADH. It's the change in osmolarity that's allowing us to reabsorb a lot of the water from the urine filtrate in the proximal convoluted tubule. And this is where we have reabsorption of a lot of our essential elements and nutrients as well. Loop of Henle, I want you to know this is where urine is concentrated. So water is reabsorbed. That's going to concentrate the urine. Distal convoluted tubule, if we need to reabsorb more water, then ADH is going to have its effect on the distal convoluted tubule to move water back into the blood supply. So reabsorption of water from the distal convoluted tubule does require antidiuretic hormone for that to occur. And distal convoluted tubule, that's where we have secretion of, most of the things that are going to be secreted are going to be secreted into the DCT. And then also look at the collecting tubule, reabsorption of water, it's also ADH required here. Okay, here's just another way to look at it. We've got water reabsorption, and that is going to concentrate the urine. And now the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. I wish that I could take credit for this acronym, for the ROSTA acronym, but I don't know who came up with it, but it's a really good acronym and it's a really good system to help you remember what's going on with the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So let's take a look at that on the whiteboard. We'll go through the ROSTA acronym, and I encourage you guys to use that acronym to help you remember the steps and everything else that's going on with the renin-angiotensin system. Okay guys, I'm gonna see how this works on the whiteboard. So let's go over the ROSTA acronym, and this is a good way for you to learn the process of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So the acronym is RAAASTAA, giving us the ROSTA sound. I'll try to make sure my hand is out of the way. So the first step in the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system is renin. And remember, renin is being released by JG cells, juxtaglomerular cells, in the kidneys
that are responding to a lack of blood flow or a lack of blood pressure in the afferent arteriole. And so those JG cells are going to release renin into the bloodstream. So something that is already in the bloodstream is a proenzyme called angiotensinogen. And remember, it's an ogen or a gen. That means it's a precursor enzyme, or it's an inactive protein. And what will happen here is when renin meets up with angiotensinogen in the blood, then they will form, renin will change angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. Where is angiotensinogen made? You need to remember that angiotensinogen is made by the liver all the time. And that's okay that it's made all the time, because it's a precursor enzyme. It's not active, but we need it there to be activated in case we do need the renin angiotensin aldosterone system to be used. All right, so we've got it in storage, the liver is always making angiotensinogen. It's floating around in the bloodstream, and if renin encounters angiotensinogen in the blood, it's going to convert angiotensinogen into angiotensin. Then this third A is for angiotensin. Oh, let me not use red. Let me use black. Angiotensin converting enzyme, or ACE. Angiotensin converting enzyme. And this enzyme is made in the lungs. There's cells in the lungs that will produce angiotensin converting enzyme, and then what that will do is ACE will be floating around in the blood, and when this enzyme interacts with angiotensin 1, then that will create or change angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. And this is our active form of angiotensin, angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 1 has a little bit of physiologic effects, but not really, nothing that we're really concerned about here. What we're really concerned about is angiotensin 2. So when angiotensin 2 gets made by ACE converting angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2, then we've got physiologic effects that are going to happen. And the effects that are going to happen are the STAA. So the S, angiotensin 2 is going to cause systemic vasoconstriction. So what does vasoconstriction result in? So if we're constricting all of the blood vessels in the body, that's going to increase blood pressure. All right, so angiotensin causes that systemic vasoconstriction. The other thing angiotensin 2 causes is an increase in thirst. It will stimulate receptors in the brain that will then trigger the thirst sensation in the body. And so hopefully that will cause that individual to consume or drink more fluids, ideally more water. And so by increasing thirst, that is hopefully going to increase blood volume, because then we've got more water in the system being absorbed by the gastrointestinal tract, and that will increase blood volume. All right, so this first A, angiotensin 2, also will cause antidiuretic hormone to be released by the pituitary gland. And remember from our lecture earlier, antidiuretic hormone is it's a hormone that will stimulate water reabsorption. And where is this water reabsorption happening? It's happening in the kidneys, specifically the distal convoluted tubule and collecting ducts. So ADH, antidiuretic hormone, it's going to increase water reabsorption from the urinary filtrate in the distal convoluted tubule and in the collecting duct and move that water back into the bloodstream. The last A is it will angiotensin 2 will stimulate the adrenal cortex to release aldosterone. And what aldosterone will do is it stimulates sodium and water reabsorption. And there, reabsorption. So again, at the renal tubules, aldosterone is going to stimulate sodium to be reabsorbed into the bloodstream, and that will cause water to follow sodium, and then we've got sodium and water reabsorption here. So let's look at these effects from everything that's happening, that's being stimulated by angiotensin 2. So angiotensin 2 is going to cause systemic vasoconstriction, which, as we already know from our cardiovascular and hematology section, that's going to increase blood pressure. Okay. Also, angiotensin 2 will stimulate thirst and that thirsty sensation, which will drive that person to drink more fluids, more water, and that will increase blood volume. So if we're increasing blood volume by consuming more water, what does that do to blood pressure? You're right, it's going to increase blood pressure. Okay, let's look at angiotensin 2 stimulating the release of antidiuretic hormone from the posterior pituitary gland. ADH is going to stimulate, or its target cells or tissue is going to be in the kidneys, the renal tubules, to increase water reabsorption. And if we're increasing water reabsorption, we're putting water back into the blood supply, and that will cause an increase in blood volume, which will cause an increase in blood pressure again. And then lastly, what angiotensin 2 will do is stimulate the adrenal cortex to secrete or to release aldosterone, which is another hormone that's going to stimulate renal tubule cells to increase sodium reabsorption and therefore water. So water is going to follow sodium in this case. And that, again, is going to increase blood volume, which is going to increase blood pressure. So remember, the whole reason why this system is happening is because the juxtaglomerular cells are recognizing that there is a decrease in blood volume or blood pressure that's going through the afferent arteriole. So that means not enough blood or not enough pressure is going into the glomerular capillaries, and so glomerular filtration is going to be deficient. And in order for the kidneys to properly do their job at metabolizing or at excreting and filtering out toxic metabolites and waste products, we need to have effective hydrostatic pressure in the glomerular capillaries. And when there's not enough pressure or blood flow to those glomerular capillaries, then the JG cells are going to release renin. And then the whole cascade of events is going to happen, because the liver is always making angiotensinogen so that it's ready to go as soon as we need it. And renin, when it interacts with angiotensinogen in the blood, will convert angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. And then the lungs special cells within the lungs are creating or making angiotensin converting enzyme, and this enzyme is released into the blood and then will interact with angiotensin 1 and convert it into the most active form, angiotensin 2. And then we have these physiologic effects right here that angiotensin 2 will stimulate, and the whole endpoint of each of these physiologic effects is to increase blood pressure. And if we increase blood pressure and blood volume, then there will be more blood volume and more pressure going through the afferent arteriole in the kidneys, and then we have more pressure driving filtration across the glomerular filtration rate. So this is the acronym that we use, ROSTA, to help us to learn and understand each step of the pathway in the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system.
Okay, coming back, let's look at the overall concept of what's happening with the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So just to sum it up, angiotensinogen made by the liver, activation of angiotensin II happens in the bloodstream, and then we've got these four physiologic effects that angiotensin II has. Let's look at it again in a different type of picture. We have renin being secreted. I shouldn't say secreted because we're talking about different type of secretion. We've got renin being released by juxtaglomerular cells in response to low blood flow through the afferent arteriole. And so low blood flow or low blood pressure going through the afferent arteriole, that's going to stimulate renin release by JG cells. Renin gets put into the bloodstream. The liver is always going to be producing angiotensinogen. Remember, it's an ogen, so it's an inactive enzyme. Renin will activate it into angiotensin 1, which will get further activated or modified by angiotensin converting enzyme. ACE is produced by the lungs and in the bloodstream activates angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. And then we've got the physiologic effects that angiotensin 2 has, like on the brain, increasing thirst. So hopefully that will encourage the individual to drink more water to increase blood volume. Has an effect on the adrenal gland to release aldosterone. And then we talked about aldosterone's effect on the kidneys, promoting sodium and therefore water reabsorption. So that's going to increase blood pressure and blood volume. And then also its effect on blood vessels. So vasoconstriction to increase blood pressure. So remember, the whole reason why this whole system gets activated is because the JG cells are not noticing that there's enough blood pressure or blood flow going into the glomerular capillaries. So in an effort to increase blood pressure and blood volume, JG cells will release renin, and that will kickstart this whole cascade of events. Another flow chart, sympathetic nervous system stimulation or hypotension or decreased sodium delivery through the afferent arteriole or even through the macula densa, or through the distal convoluted tubule measured by the macula densa cells, that's going to stimulate the juxtaglomerular cells to release renin. And renin goes into the blood supply, activates angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. Angiotensin converting enzyme will then convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. And then that will cause systemic vasoconstriction, increased thirst, which hopefully will increase blood volume, will stimulate the pituitary gland to release antidiuretic hormone, which will cause water reabsorption from the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting ducts. And then also angiotensin II is going to stimulate the adrenal cortex of the adrenal gland to release aldosterone, which will have an effect on renal tubules to reabsorb sodium, and therefore water. All of these things are going to increase blood volume, which is going to increase blood pressure. And then the JG cells will be happy with the amount of blood pressure that they're checking out going through the afferent arteriole. Because remember, in order to have effective filtration, we need to have a proper or an adequate glomerular capillary hydrostatic pressure, or a glomerular capillary blood pressure to drive that filtration. All right, well, what happens if angiotensin II is activated all the time or is present all the time? Well, that's what this slide is talking about. That can cause endothelial damage. And as we know now, damage to endothelial cells can lead to atherosclerosis, and it can lead to plaque formation and even complicated plaque formation. Also, angiotensin II long-term decreases apoptosis of cells. So if we have a decrease in apoptosis, what can that lead to, or what does that increase the risk of? If you're thinking that it will increase the risk of cancer, you're right. Because then if we have damaged or mutated cells, if they're not going to be stimulated to undergo apoptosis, then they're going to hang around and potentially turn into cancerous cells. Also can increase platelet aggregation, increase smooth muscle growth in blood vessels, leading to complicated atherosclerosis and even arteriosclerosis and so on. So we don't want the angiotensin-aldosterone system activated all the time. We only want it activated when there's not enough blood flow or blood volume going through the afferent arteriole. So let's look at one hormone in particular, aldosterone. And this is a flow chart that I'm hoping you guys will use as a guide or a template for the other hormones that we're going to look at later on in the quarter. So if we have an increase in aldosterone, which is coming from the adrenal cortex of the adrenal gland, that's stimulated by angiotensin II. Anyway, we've got an increase in aldosterone that's going to lead to increased sodium reabsorption. So reabsorption, we're moving sodium from the urine filtrate back into the blood supply. Water is going to follow sodium, and then that will increase blood volume, which will ultimately increase cardiac output. All right, shifting gears a little bit to wrap up the normal structure and function of the urinary tract and the renal systems. Let's look at a couple other characteristics here. So the urine of the pH has a big range, 4.6 to 8.0. That's considered normal range of pH for the urine. Why do you think there's such a huge gradient here? Why is there such a big difference? It's because, remember, the kidneys play that important role in helping to regulate pH and blood and body pH. So we need to have the capability of altering urine pH to have effective kidney compensation for pH changes. And most of that comes from hydrogen ion secretion. Or excretion, or not secreting or excreting hydrogen ions. And then also remember, the liver, like we talked about in the GI section, will take ammonia, which is really toxic, and convert it into urea, which is much less toxic. And then the kidneys will get rid of that extra urea, or even to a certain extent ammonia. And then it exits the body by way of urination, and then we get rid of that toxic metabolite. So remember, if the liver is diseased or if the liver is failing, then we're going to have the buildup of ammonia. Kidneys can only try and take care of so much ammonia. and then it becomes this potent neurotoxin leading to hepatic encephalopathy. Other hormones that are produced or modified by the kidneys. So urodilantin, which is basically natriuretic peptide, is going to inhibit sodium and water reabsorption. So that's just kind of a complicated way of saying that it's going to promote sodium and water secretion and therefore decreasing blood volume. Vitamin D gets activated by kidney cells, and we need vitamin D to have effective calcium absorption in the gut. If we don't have kidneys that are functioning right or activating vitamin D properly, then over time we'll develop a calcium deficiency because calcium won't be absorbed effectively in the gut because there won't be enough vitamin D around. Don't forget about EPO, erythropoietin. When there is not enough oxygenation to the kidneys, JG cells are going to release EPO, and that'll stimulate bone marrow to produce more red blood cells in an effort to increase oxygenation to the kidney. And then also renin, released by juxtaglomerular cells, and that will kickstart the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. So why does renin get released? It's basically because the JG cells are recognizing that there's not enough blood pressure or blood volume going through the afferent arteriole to have effective glomerular filtration to occur. So low blood pressure in the kidneys, low blood flow to the kidneys, that's going to stimulate the JG cells to release renin into the bloodstream, and that'll kickstart the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. And the end products of that are going to help increase blood volume. Let's talk about how we can test renal function for a few minutes. Basically, we can measure glomerular filtration rate in the lab and also measure the clearance. Clearance of substances like creatinine. Creatinine is a protein metabolite. So the human body produces a pretty steady amount of creatinine day in and day out because of it's a byproduct of muscle activity, and we can measure the concentration of creatinine in the blood. And if the creatinine is increasing in the blood, then that is suggestive that we don't have effective glomerular filtration happening, because we do typically have a pretty set amount of creatinine that does get filtered out. So if the kidneys are not filtering properly, or if there's something wrong with the filtration membrane, then creatinine will increase in the blood. And we can also measure blood urea nitrogen, or BUN. Nitrogen is another byproduct of protein metabolism. And if the kidneys are not secreting or filtering right, then this urea is going to accumulate in the blood. And that's another indication of renal dysfunction. All right, so that's the end of the normal structure and function of the kidneys and the renal system, urinary tract. I like this picture because if I ever had a lawn ornament, I would want this one. Because the whole purpose of most of what we talked about today is to form urine. And we've got a lot of toxic metabolites and so on in the urine that the body needs to get rid of. And if I had this lawn ornament, I would have a pot of flowers right where this stream of water is ending. I just think that would be awesome. All right, guys. So if you have any questions about this lecture, be sure to email me or talk to me when I see you again, and I can help you clear it up. And I hope you're having a good weekend, and I'll see you guys next time.